Me on syndicatednews.net, and we're talking to James W. Loewen, author of Lies My Teacher Told Me. And the reason he's extremely important to Syndicated News right now is because George Zimmerman used a reference from the book and two other sources and posted them on his website. Jim, are you with us?
I am.
Tell us about this. What's your opinion of this?
My first reaction would be, in a way, kind of cool, because he quotes exactly four people, three of whom are dead, and I'm in pretty good company. He quotes Henrik Ibsen, the famous playwright, Thomas Paine, patriot and author of Common Sense, of course. He quotes Edmund Burke, the famous quote, "All that is needed for evil to triumph is for good men to do nothing." And he quotes me, James W. Loewen. Well, all right. The next thing I noticed is that what he quotes by me, he doesn't rip out of context. That is to say, it's not distorting something I said. It's something like this. I'm just going to do it from memory now. Everyone has a right to his own opinion, but you don't have a right to your own facts. You have to use real facts, not created facts, facts everybody can agree on. After those two positive aspects, we then get to the point, however, that people I know and people worse who I don't know might infer Loewen is somehow on Zimmerman's side or somehow part of Zimmerman's defense team. And indeed, when I saw this reported on CNN, on MSNBC, I didn't see it on CBS, but I understand it was on it. What you saw the day that his website was posted was the CBS or the MSNBC or whoever it was talking head talking in front of the part of his website that has my quote with my name stuck there. So now I'm identified with George Zimmerman. I didn't need that 15 seconds worth of fame.
This is a wonderful book, Lies My Teacher Told Me, and I was surprised that he would quote it.
Well, not only that, the phrase he quotes, the two sentences that he quotes, are on page 367, I think, toward the end of the book. Now, I suspect that somebody told him about all these quotes. I must say, if he did read the whole book, the book is about what we get wrong when we teach American history, particularly when we teach it K-12, that is, in public schools, well, even in private schools, because the textbooks are so bad. Furthermore, I show in that book that the textbooks usually are not written by the authors whose names are listed as the folks who have written them. Kind of an interesting little sidebar.
Tell us about that.
This hit me upside the head. I'd already known it before, but it hit me upside the head when I was writing the second and current and final edition of the book. The book came out first in 1994, and it sold so well and all that people have a touching belief in progress in America. And so they've told me around 2000 or 2002, around in there, well, you know, the books you analyzed were from the 1980s. They must have gotten better since then. So I resolved to come up with a new edition, and in 2007 or 2008, I did. And it's based on my intensive reading of six new high school history textbooks, all published after the year 2000. So it has a new chapter on how we misteach the Iraq War, basically the entire Bush administration. When I'm reading these six new textbooks about that subject, I had an aha experience. I said to myself, wait a minute, didn't I just read this? And I was at the moment reading a history textbook written by two very famous historians, and by written by, I actually mean not written by, as you'll see, Daniel Boorstin, formerly the Librarian of Congress and two-time, I think, Pulitzer Prize winner at Yale University. And I'm reading this book, and sure enough, I searched through the other five books. And see, apparently nobody's ever read these books one after another, even the adoption committees. I find the same material on the Iraq War, the same material. I mean, every paragraph is identical, except maybe one paragraph has the word "very" added to it. The photographs are identical. The captions are identical. For page after page, these two books, allegedly by two completely different sets of authors, the other book is written by four folks, allegedly, and the new part of it is written by Robin Winkler, who is distinguished professor of history at Miami University in Ohio. So I called them up. I didn't call Boorstin because he recently died, but I called his co-author, and his co-author implied that Boorstin did it. Not that Boorstin cheated, but that Boorstin wrote the material. And I said to him, well, you know, for several pages on end, paragraph after paragraph, it is identical to this other book. And the guy I was talking with, Brooks Mather Kelly is his name, he says to me, and I quote, "Oh no, that's terrible." Pretty soon he admits that his co-author didn't write it. He says, quote, "Prentice Hall hired somebody to write it. I forget the man's name." So the alleged authors don't even know the name of the author of their book. They don't know his qualifications. They don't know anything about him. So then I called the other guy, Winkler, and I said, and he implied that he had written his work. And I said, well, did you know that it's identical to this other book by Bushton and Kelly? And Winkler said, oh no, that's terrible. He actually said the same thing. And then pretty soon he admitted that he didn't write it. And I asked him, I said, well, aside from the fact that you didn't write it, what do you think of it as a work of history? And he said, and I quote, just a minute, let me get it down from the shelf. Meaning, how would I know? I've never read it. Now, I submit to you that if you are silly enough as a college sophomore to buy your term paper for $9.95 off the web, we at least hope you have enough brains to read the thing before you turn it into the professor. These authors have no idea what they wrote. So the textbooks are a problem. My book points this out. But much of my book focuses on issues of race relations, first beginning with American Indians. And I point out that the traditional storyline, which is basically that we started out great and we've been getting better ever since. And the storyline with regard to American Indians is, well, they had a perfectly good culture and everything, but they just couldn't adapt and adopt our ways fast enough, and so they kind of fell behind, and now we're trying to help them. Well, the problem with that is it's not true, and I show why it's not true, how it's not true. Then we get into black-white race relations, and my point is then that if George Zimmerman read 367 pages, not all of it is about race relations by any means, but a bunch of it is, and it didn't seem to have worked. It didn't seem to have rubbed off.
I would be very impressed if he had read it at all.
I don't think so. Well, we don't know. I have the feeling that we are going to get some facts coming out in this case if it does finally go to trial. But I don't think anybody's going to ask him this question. Did you really read Loewen's book?
Let's see if someone asks him.
This is James W. Loewen, author of Lies My Teacher Told Me, and I'm on syndicatednews.net.
And just stories of the road. Thank you for the freedom when it came my time to go. Thank you for your kindness and the times when you got tough. And Papa, I don't think I've said I love you near enough. The leader of the band is tired and his eyes are growing old. His blood runs through my instrument, and the song is in my soul. Life has been a poor attempt to imitate the man. I'm just a living legacy to the leader of the band. I am a living legacy to the leader.